Today, during announcements, I said the name of the title of the message was going to be war and kind of God's view or what our the biblical view of war should be. And, you know, in light of kind of the current political and world situations that's going on, specifically between us and Iran, and the whole Middle East, of course, is kind of a mess, and kind of where that leads us. And you know, I believe it was as of today, Iran raised the red flag of doom over one of its most famous mosques there, symbolizing that war is imminent, and that you know, they've symbolizing that. You know, the words actually on the flag says that they want to avenge the blood of Hussein. You know, it was written across this flag, and really what it means in like Shiite tradition, that it symbolizes blood that was spilt unjustly. So in other words, they're kind of, you know, saying or letting it be known that they're getting ready to avenge the death of the general that we took out, you know. And so it's one of those things where you have all these back and forth word, you know, threats going across. The commander of the Islamic Revolutionary Guard said on Friday that they've already identified 35 potential targets that they're going to strike, you know, U.S. targets. And you know, so all these things are going on, and then our president countered, you know, that America has already identified 52 different targets that if there was any kind of action against America, that they were going to hit immediately. And, you know, so we've got all these resources going to the Middle East, and you know, the Middle East is just kind of a powder keg right now. Well, it always has been and always will be until the Lord comes. But, you know, right now it's in the news a lot. And, you know, I just thought it would be good for us to really kind of dive in. And as Christians, what should be our perspective on this? What should be our attitude about war? Is war ever okay, you know, as far as, you know, a Christian worldview? And really, over the years, the church has kind of adopted, you know, three different views on it. The first one is that no war is ever okay. You know, kind of pacifism is really what it is. And another view is that, you know, if the government's co-signed it, then, you know, we're to follow along with it, which really is activism. Or the third one is, you know, there's times in our world that, you know, God's called us to deal with evil. And really that's called the just war theory. And really that would probably be closest to what we in this church would represent. It'd be more, you know, there's times, you know, because we do live in a fallen world. We live in an evil world. We live in a world that there are other world views, other religions that want to do us harm. And we have to deal with it. It's just that simple, you know. Evil has to be dealt with. And so really that's kind of, you know, I would say would be where we stand as a church. Because, you know, if you would turn to Romans chapter 3 with me, and we'll just take a quick look at that. I'm already deviating from my message, but that's okay. That's kind of what I do. I would like to think that's just being led by the Holy Spirit, but Romans chapter 3, we'll take a look at verse 10 through 18. And it says, "As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. They have all turned aside. They have altogether become unprofitable. There is none who does good, no, not one. Their throat is an open tomb. With their tongues they have practiced deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. And in the way of peace, they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. You know, unfortunately, I don't know about you, but in a lot of cases, that describes the world that we live in. That describes really, as the church, our mission field, isn't it? You know, those are the kind of the times that we live in. But, you know, the question is like I said, what really should be our view on all this? I mean, you know, Romans is pretty clear here that there is evil in the world. There is wickedness. There are those who are not and don't want to follow God. And there are those who are so opposed to the God of the Bible, you know, that the thought of us following Christ would be a capital offense in their countries. You know, such evil regimes. And how are we supposed to do it? Obviously, I said it this morning, the foundation of the church is prayer. The first thing we need to do is pray for those people. You know, that's the most important thing that we can do as a church is pray. You know, we're supposed to pray how? Always and without ceasing. And just, you know, just because they are opposed and really, you know, we're considered in the Islamic world to be the great Satan and Israel's the little Satan. There's nothing more than they would like to do than to, you know, remove us from the earth, you know, blow us up, whatever. But I can't think of a better reason to pray for them, right? You know, or we could take the Jonah approach, right? God called us to go minister to these people, but it was like, why, God? If I go and share the gospel with them, then they're going to repent and they're going to get saved and your judgment won't come upon them. And what fun is that? You know, I really don't like these people, but I know if I go preach the gospel, then they're going to hear it and they're going to respond and then they're going to repent and you're not going to, you know, put judgment upon them. And we really don't want that, Lord. You know, if we're going to be truthful, we really don't want that. But that's what God's called us to do, isn't it? We need to pray. It all begins with prayer. That's one of the things, but God has, in the Bible said that in the particular case, let's go back to the general that we took out. You know, many years ago in the Obama administration, this guy was designated a terrorist. And over the last few months, we had plenty of intel that which led up to the strike and when we were able to kill him. You know, he specifically was attributed to killing 600 and something Americans and were plotting and planning other attacks on America assets and American people. So, you know, taking him out, you know, to me was the right thing to do. And God would kind of back that up. You know, I know some people who read Exodus 20 and it says that you shall not kill, you know, kind of take that out of context or don't truly understand what it's saying there. The word there used in Hebrew is really, you know, no premeditated murder. You know, we're not supposed to murder somebody, which is obviously killing somebody without just cause or what have you. That's what that's talking about there. But there's times where God instructed, for instance, the nation of Israel to go and wipe out whole civilizations. You know, that they were so far gone that God didn't want men, women, or children there. He wanted them all wiped out, even their animals. Why? You know, because he knew that if they were to save some of the people or make them slaves or whatever, then those cultures would get into Israel and would end up infecting it, right? And we know throughout the Bible how Israel was prone to wander away from the true and living God. And so, for instance, in First Samuel chapter 15, he says, Samuel also said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, heed the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he ambushed him on the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have and do not spare them. Kill both man, woman, infant, and nursing child, ox, sheep, camel, and donkey. You know, God said, you know what? I want you to wipe this whole civilization out. Why? Because like I said, you know, they were so evil that, of course, God is a perfect judge, right? And so why would God spare one nation that was completely evil? Like the Ninevites, right? When he sent Jonah and they repented. But he didn't with these guys. Why is it? Well, God knows. You know, I mean, he knows who's going to repent and who's not going to repent. And he was looking out after the nation of Israel. And there's other times when God, told reasons why there's capital punishment or why, you know, the justified killing of somebody. For instance, in Exodus 21, verses 12 through 17, he says, "He who strikes a man so that he dies shall surely be put to death. However, if he did not lie in wait, but delivered him into his hand, then I appoint you a place where you may flee. But if a man acts with premeditation against his neighbor to kill him by treachery, you shall take him from my altar that he may die. And he who strikes his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. He who kidnaps a man and sells him, or if he is found in his hand, shall surely be put to death. And he who curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death." You know, so God, in all circumstances, God ain't necessarily against killing someone when it's dealing with punishing evil, right? And that's what we see here. And thank God it's changed a little bit, you know, because, it's talking about anybody who has striked his mother or father or cursed his parents or whatever. In the culture we live in, how many people would be on death row? You know, it's true. We got people raising their hand in the back over here. It really wasn't a question. It was called rhetorical. I'll explain it later, okay? But hey, you know, it's true. It really is. And it's unfortunate to that's the culture we live in. But hey, you know, God gives us, certain criteria for these things. And we understand it because it said in Romans, we live in an evil world. We live in an evil time, don't we? And it's just the way it is. So as we think about it, and you know, as Christians, the one thing that we do know from Genesis on, you know, we were created in the image of God. Genesis 1 tells us that we were created in His image. And because we were created in God's image, if we were to... as it says in Psalm 8, verses 4 through 6, it says, "What is man that you take thought of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than God, and you crown him with glory and majesty. You make him to rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet." You know, we're made in the image of God. And just the understanding of that, it's an amazing thing. And so when we inexcusably or without justification kill somebody, God says, you know, you've taken somebody that was in my image and you killed them, you know. I find it interesting, kind of in this argument, the same people who are against, for instance, America going to war or waging a just war are perfectly okay with the murder of unborn babies. You know, they don't give it a second thought that almost 64 million children have been murdered in the United States, that we've waged war against the most vulnerable humans on the earth, those in the womb, and yet they throw an absolute fit because we killed an evil general. Those same exact people that are throwing a fit over the fact that we took out this evil person co-signs on the fact that abortion is legal in the United States. Yet we really are waging war on the most innocent there is. You know, but they don't see it that way. You know, it's just the world that we live in, and it's unfortunate. But it's unfortunately the truth, isn't it? You know, that you can be so upset, like I said, about taking one evil person out that wants to do harm to the United States, yet those almost 64 million babies, it's okay. You know, it's a choice. Something to kind of chew on, isn't it? You know, but God doesn't see it that way because God sees all life as precious. You know, God sees, we were all created in the image of God, but some of us, you know, have chosen evil, right? And sometimes we have to deal with it. But the innocent in the womb haven't chose. You know, as it says in Genesis 9, it says, "Surely I will require your life blood. From every beast I will require it, and from every man, from every man's brother, I will require the life of man. Whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed. For in the image of God he was made." You know, God doesn't take it lightly, does he? You know, and neither should we, because God created us in his image. You know, so where's the balance here? Well, we know that the balance is a couple of things. First and foremost is that God created government, or God puts government in place to punish evildoers. And we know that 1 Timothy chapter 2 says, "Therefore I exhort, first of all, that supplications, prayers, and intercessions and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence." Listen, you know, God put the leaders and kings in place. You know, the scripture tells us that. And what it tells us here is that we're supposed to pray for them. Right? We're supposed to pray for their wisdom. We're supposed to pray for their protection. We're supposed to pray. Once again, it goes back to, we're supposed to pray for our leaders. We're, you know, as it also says, every person is to be in subjection to governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God. And those which exist are established by God. Therefore, whoever resists authority has opposed the ordinance of God. And they who have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. For rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior, but for evil. Do you want to have no fear of authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For it is a minister of God to you for good. But if you do what is evil, be afraid. For it does not bear the sword of nothing, for it is a minister of God, an avenger who brings wrath on the one who practices evil. Therefore, it is necessary to be in subjection, not only because of wrath, but also for conscience sake. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for rulers are servants of God, devoting themselves to this very thing. Render to all what is due them, tax to whom tax is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, and honor to whom honor. That's Romans chapter 13, the first 7 verses. That's how we're supposed to respond. That's how we should be, you know, praying for our leadership. We should be praying for their wisdom. We should be praying for, you know, that they make the right and godly choices, because it says that God is the one who put them in place. You know, and us as a church, we're supposed to lift them up in prayer. Regardless of our political ideology, regardless of who's in office, it doesn't matter if, for instance, right now, if you like Trump or you don't like Trump, that's really not our place as Christians. Our job is to pray for him, is to pray for him. That's our job. You know, it says in 2 Peter, it says, "Submit yourself for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether to a king as the one in authority, or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and praise of those who do right." You know, these verses indicate that God gives them the responsibility to carry out punishment against evildoers, right? And that's what the government is supposed to do. So when you hear about, you know, the, for instance, in the news, we've taken out a terrorist, well, that's the government doing what the government's supposed to do according to God's word. And that should be something that we should pray for them for wisdom of. You know, so there are times where, you know, we really need to understand, you know, the role of the government, the role of our government, and what our really our view on war should be. There are times when war is just. You know, there's also times where it says that war is out of greed, where war is out of, you know, just evilness, whatever the case may be. But there are times when war is just, and that we need to do it. It's our responsibility according to God's word, and I think it's something that, you know, first and foremost, as we think about it, not only do we need to be praying about or praying for our leadership, but man, we need to be praying for those who are serving, those who have boots on the ground, who are protecting our freedoms and our way of life. Because there's a lot of people out there that, you know, would like to destroy our way of life, but there's a lot of brave men and women who are protecting it. You know, that. So we definitely need to pray for our soldiers, that's for sure. You know, and also, beyond praying, what do we need to do? And this is probably the most important part. This is how the church needs to be active. The church needs to wage war. And the church needs to wage war, and the church has its marching orders. If you would turn to Ephesians chapter 6, this is where we're going to spend the rest of our message. You know, Ephesians chapter 6, the full armor of God, beginning in verse 10, says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded up your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak." You know, I know in the ministry, every morning we put on the armor of God. Why? Because as a Christian, it's the only way we can even get through the day. It's the only way that we can, you know, because the key here is in the first part of the voices where it says we don't wrestle, you know, against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. You know, the war that we wage is not a physical war. It's a spiritual war. And I guarantee you, if the church was really actively engaged in this war, we wouldn't have all these problems that we see now. Because as Pastor Troy said this morning, the only hope is Jesus Christ. The only hope. So if you want to stop, you know, these other cultures from waging war against the United States or against what the United States or Israel believes, it's by introducing them to Jesus Christ. It's through the gospel. That's the only way. And it's only the gospel. It's not going to be through, you know, political maneuvers. It's not going to be against threats. It's only through Jesus Christ that these things happen. And it's only when we as Christians start waging war and the way that we're called to here in Ephesians 6, and it all begins once again with us praying. You know, that we're putting on the full armor of God, and it says we're praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. You know, each and every one of us here has the ability to pray. We might not have the ability, you know, to go out, walk out into the neighborhoods and preach the gospel to people or serve in other capacities, but each and every one of us can pray. Every one of us can be in, join the battle in prayer. Not every one of us is called to be up here, or not every one of us is called to, you know, the different ministries in this church in the sense of being out and active, because not all of us can do that, or we're not in that season of our lives. But every one of us is capable of praying. And that's really where the battle is won. That's where the battle begins, and that's where the battle ends, is with prayer. You know, the rest of it is important, but I don't know how else to put it. It's prayer, and only prayer. You know, even the end of it, it says in verse 19, it says, "And for me, that the utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I, in it, I may speak boldly as I ought to speak." You know, I love this. You know, he's kind of urging the reader, isn't he? Hey, pray for me that I may have that the boldness to give the utterance of the gospel, that I can speak the truth, you know, to people who are against it. Because there's one thing that the gospel will do. There's one thing that God's word will do. You know, I don't care. I don't know. Maybe you've experienced this true. You can open up a book in front of somebody, right? Let's say you're on an airplane or whatever. You can open a book. It could be any other book in the Bible and people won't care. You can open up the Bible and you know, and I've seen this where people just physically start squirming. You know, you're not even talking to them about it. You're just sitting there reading your Bible and they're like, "Whoa, could you put that thing away?" And it's like, "Why? You don't believe in it. So what's it matter, the Bible? Or why do you care if I pray for you if you don't believe there's a God who hears the prayer?" But they get so upset because you're, you know, "Hey, can I pray?" "No, don't pray for me." It's like, "Why? It's just empty words if you don't believe in God anyway." So, no. You know, but that's the way the world works, isn't it? That's those principalities, those powers. You know, another example is in the culture, the culture that we live in. You know, we'll take books of antiquity. Wrong term here, but you know, where we have just a few manuscripts of them, and people will take them as you know, being exact or being an accurate copy of what was written. Yet, you know, that's with just a few hundred copies. Yet, like of the Bible, we have of the Old Testament, like 65,000 copies that some of them dating back to real close to the original autographs, the original writings of it, and they're disputed. Why? Because it's okay to believe that Homer's Iliad, for example, is accurate, because you don't have to change your life based on Homer's Iliad. But with all these thousands and tens of thousands of early manuscripts of the Bible, now if you believe those are accurate, then you got to deal with your sin. And people don't want to do that. They would rather stay in their darkness, right? That's the way the world is. And we see parts of the world in all these countries where if you're converted to Christianity or you come to know the truth, it's a death sentence. Why? Because they know if I were to go like this, and there's a little darkness in there, none of you can see it in the light. But if I were to turn every light off and black at every window, and I shine just a teeny light, all of you could see it in the darkness. Because the light pierces the darkness. The darkness doesn't pierce the light, right? And that's the same way with us waging war. It begins because we know the truth. And we have that little light, don't we? Makes me want to sing that song, "This Little Light of Mine," but I'm not going to. But it's the truth. If we want to wage war, it's through Ephesians 6. It's not, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. It's not, be strong and in your power and in your might. No, it's be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. See, because in us, there's nothing good. But it's Christ shining through us that we can have an impact. It's Christ shining through us with that little light of ours that pierces into the darkness. And when the church wakes up enough to really start praying and putting on the armor of God and waging war, then a lot of these physical wars will cease, right? Because those who are opposed to Christianity, how do you change that? It's not through bombs, it's through the gospel. It's that simple. And that's what we're seeing here. They use the analogy of a soldier here with all the different aspects of the full armor of God, knowing that this is where our war is waged, isn't it? This is where we fight our battles, as the song Terry sang is, because it's true. That's where our battles are fought and won. It's in His power and in His might and not ours. So how do we do that? Once again, we pray for our leaders. We pray for our enemies. We pray that we would, like it said here, that we would have the courage to boldly open our mouths with the gospel of peace. And that's what our responsibility as Christians are. That's where it belongs with us, so that we too could say, you know what? We're an ambassador in chains, but we can speak boldly. Because I can tell you this, we are the only ones with the truth. There's not more than one truth. Jesus is the only truth. There's not more than one way to God, even though the world would like you to believe it. Oh, as long as you're sincere, or as long as you're whatever, all roads lead to heaven. No, really, all roads lead to hell but one. And that's Jesus Christ, because He is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other way to the Father except through Him. Amen? Amen. All right. Well, I know I kind of glossed over the subject of what we're dealing with, but I hope it gave you a little idea, or maybe piqued some your mind to think of some questions or whatever. So everybody who's listening online and those who are here in the sanctuary, if you have any questions, Jerry has the microphone for you here in the sanctuary. You can raise your hand and I'll be happy to answer any questions after we go before the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank You for who You are. Lord, we thank You for just knowing that You're in control, Lord. And God, that we don't have to do this on our own, Lord. That we can live this life in Your power and in Your might. Lord, that we can rely on You. And that in these evil days, You've given us everything we need to take a stand, Lord. God, You've given us every weapon that we need to fight this spiritual battle. And Lord, we just thank You for equipping us. God, I pray that You would wake the church up here in America, Lord. And God, that we would become soldiers. God, that we would be, fight our battles from our knees, Lord, in prayer. God, that we would speak boldly Your truths. So, Lord, I do pray for, all that's going on in the Middle East, Lord, and the decisions that we're making as a country. Lord, I pray for our president and his staff, Lord, that You would guide them. Lord, that that their choices would be, they would seek You for them, Lord. And God, I pray for Iran and Iraq and all those countries that are opposed to the truth, Lord. The truth of You, God, that You would send revival to them too, Lord. That they could be like Nineveh and repent, Lord. God, that they would come to know you in a real way. And Lord, because the one thing I do know, the one thing that I've discovered the longer that I've been walking with you, Lord, is nothing is impossible with you, Lord. God, that you can do anything. So Lord, we pray for those people over there, Lord, that are that the enemy has deceived. God, we pray that for their deliverance. So Lord, we know that you're the only hope. So God, we give all these situations to you. We pray your protection upon the soldiers and those who maintain our freedom, Lord, through their bravery and courage. God, keep them safe. Bring them back to us, Lord, unharmed. So, Lord, we give you this time now. Lord, we pray as we get ready to open up the question and answer that, God, you would be glorified in that too. So we just thank you and praise you. And it's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. All right. So do we have any questions here in the sanctuary?
Again, thanks, Kevin, for taking us into uncharted territory with something like war and things like that. The question I have is, we live in an immediate, intense environment. So what do you choose to believe? There's so many different choices. On my cell phone, I can pick 5 different news services who'll tell me 5 different things that happen. So I find it really hard to know what the truth is anymore.
And using the current situation that the media is in, I don't know if you're ever going to find the truth. You know, once again, that comes from, I think, prayerful discernment, to be honest with you. I know for me, it's the same way. It's like, well, if you listen to, for instance, one news agency, then the attack that took out the general was completely unjust, and the poor guy, was just murdered unjustly, And then you turn on another news agency, and it was like, yeah, we've had intel for months, and this is something that needed to be done to save the lives of many more because there was imminent threats that this guy had. And you know, what's the truth? I don't know. It's one of those things where, once again, I don't know if we'll never get the truth out of the media, let's be honest. It's just not exactly, they're not really acquainted with the truth anymore. You know, I heard the term journalism is dead, and that's kind of the truth. So it goes back to me, it's just relying on God's word and trying to just take the facts and pray about them more than anything else. You know, what else can we do? Because like I said, you're going to get a spin regardless, especially as divided as our country is politically, spiritually, whatever, you're going to get the same exact event is going to be spun one way here and spun another way here. And like I said, neither one of them, they're both lying to you just from different angles kind of thing. That might be a little cynical, but that's kind of what I see. That's why I honestly try not to watch too much of the news other than the, like I said, just get the facts about it. So I don't know if that helps, but it's just kind of like I said, just being God's word. We've got a question back there, Jerry.
Thank you very much for taking on this subject. If ever there was a time that the body of Christ needs to come together, it is now, because if we are truly aware of what God's word says, we are in the end times. And this is the time when we, as the body of Christ, need to tell all people, shout it from the rooftops. This is inevitable. This is what Revelations is about. And so we just need to be, I agree with you, in prayer about this, because we are privileged people to be living in such a time as this, because we're experiencing it. That's all I wanted to say.
Well, and the bottom line is this too. It's you know, there's the old theology. You know, it's the theory of expectancy. We should be expecting the Lord to return anytime, because He could return at any time, and we should be living our lives as He is going to return at any time. We don't know. You know, a day is like 1,000 years to Him. We don't know how long it is before the Lord's going to return. But, you know, at the same time, you know, it's our job, you know, to live every day like He's going to return. But at the same time, it's just, you know, we have to persevere. And we also have to make sure we don't engage in newspaper theology, you know, where every event, we're a scrub, oh, that's it. Okay, it's on now, you know, when we really don't know, you know, like I said, once again, because you see a lot of that too, you know, it's like, there's certain authors, you know, or people as a literature that I find, it's like everybody who's elected president or pope or what, up there, the Antichrist. I know it's this time, this person's the Antichrist. It's like, you don't know that. You have no idea until they desecrate the temple, and there's not a temple yet, so I don't really think you know what you're talking about. You know what type of thing, but there's always that kind of, we have to be careful there too, is just to keep things, you know, keep seeking His word, and just not trying to jump to conclusions on every little thing and that happens on the world stage, because we don't, you know, we just don't know. But you're right. The one thing we do know is we're closer than when we first believed that the Lord's going to be coming back. So, all right. I think Mike had a question. Right?
Hello. So, I like the verse that you read out of Romans, because it, and like in two verses, it has like an answer, and you've shared and broken answer down, and it says, and the way of peace they have not known. And I believe my Bible says that Jesus is peace, and there is no fear of God before their eyes. And we see that if we're people that sit there and watch the news. And one of the things that I think is kind of interesting, because it is that in all these things that are happening, God still is in control. You said it. It's His plan, I believe. And you can help me out with that one. But I believe everything that happens, whether we consider it a carnal war in the Middle East that's been going on for several thousand years, and the Bible says that there will be an ending war, and all these, like you brought up the temple and all these things, it's like if we just, we realize that, like you said, the key is in prayer and being in God's word. We may not always understand God's ways and His plans, but for sure, I think those are all going to come about. And all these things that we people are fearful in is usually, if we're fearful in, it's because we're not in prayer deep enough, and we're not in His word.
No, I completely agree. And I think sometimes, you know, for instance, what's going on in the Middle East can really detract us from the true evils that are happening. I brought up abortion. You know, we're so focused on, you know, what's going on in the Middle East and the few people who have died there, but
homeless, drugs, everything.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at all that's going on in the United States that the church should be dealing with, abortion, you know, almost 64 million babies have been murdered. You know, like you were saying, the homeless, opioid addiction, there's so many different battles that the church should be waging here, you know, to get... we need to keep everything in perspective. You know, yeah, we need to deal with evil. We need to deal with Iran. We need to deal with Iraq. We need to deal with all these people that want to do us harm. But what about all the harm we're doing our own citizens? You know, we've exterminated 64 million of them almost. You know, so we got to keep it in perspective too. Yeah, we need to deal with that, but we also need to deal with this. And that's where the church needs to be waging war from an Ephesians 6 perspective, you know, that we need to be doing these things. We need to be on our knees in prayer. We need to be putting on the full armor of God. We need to take back ground that the church is willingly given away to the enemy to be politically correct so that people like us or that we don't seem harsh or whatever the case may be. No, we've given up the schools. We've given up, you know, the courts. We've given up all the political offices. We've given up all these things. And it's time that we get back and put on the full armor of God and take the war back to the enemy. You know, we've lost our resolve to do that in general as a church. I'm not saying this church necessarily, but in general, the church corporately in the United States, we've allowed the enemy, or really we've openly given the enemy a lot of ground that we should never have given them. You know, we've given them the schools. So we're allowing a bunch of evil stuff to pollute our young kids, you know, indoctrinate them from a very young age. We've lost that battle, but we need to start get back into that skirmish, and we need to take our school systems back. You know, that's at the youngest age, and then boy, by the time you get to the university level, the stuff that is tolerated and taught there is absolutely ridiculous. You know, but we've allowed it. Our taxpayer dollars is doing that, and we're not standing up saying anything. You know, we're pacifistic about all this stuff. You know, we're voting in politicians that, you know, run on the fact that it's a woman's choice, it's not a child, you know, that abortion's okay, and all these other different things that we've allowed. The church, we're going to be accountable for that. It's time that we rise up as a church and we fight that battle. You know, I don't know how else to put it, but, you know, so like I said, yes, we need to be concerned about the Middle East and we need to be concerned about these things, but we also need to look inwardly too.
So basically, really, everybody, before an individual is willing to come to Jesus and ask him to be as their Lord and Savior and ask forgiveness and repentance of their sins, Khomeini or any other radical individual is just a sinner. And we, like you said, we should also be praying for those people too.
Yeah,
for not only for those that protect us in our country and the world at large, but for our enemy. I think it said, you know, that Jesus said that, you know, to give your enemy water if he's thirsty and give him food. That's a little bit different than talking about, you know, wiping out a guy that has killed 600-something Americans in this snap. But there is no difference between a sinner, correct? I mean, sinner's a sinner, and well, everybody needs to come to repentance of the Lord.
Absolutely, and you know, what's it say? Before we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we're an enemy of God, right? We're at enmity with God. And it's the same thing. You know, each and every one of us, you know, we're in our sin just like they are over there. It's just we find our own sin a lot more tolerable than their sin, right? But in God's eyes, sin is sin. You know, what's the difference? It's all the same to God. It's all sin. So yeah, you know, the key is repentance, you know, coming to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And like I said earlier, you know, at sometimes I think we limit what God can do, or we limit in our own minds. We don't think it's possible that God can cause a revival in Iran, for instance. Why not? He's God, you know, he can do anything. But how many of us honestly can say we've ever prayed or pray for those people over there that are deceived and raised in this darkness, you know? You know, it's not something that, unless a circumstance like we have on the world stage now, that I think, I'll be honest, you know, I need to repent of that. I don't always pray for those, you know, those Islamic countries or whatever. You know, when For instance, ISIS used to show the videos of them killing Christians. I wasn't praying for those guys' soul. I was praying a missile would hit, you know, and wipe them out. I wasn't praying for them. That's something I got to repent of, but I'm just being honest, you know. It's kind of that flesh thing. You see them behead somebody. I wasn't thinking, Lord, save that person that just cut that guy's head off. No, I was thinking, send a missile and hit him directly in the head, Lord. You know, or better yet, let it be off a little bit and let him suffer before he dies. I'm just being honest here. You know, that's me and my flesh. But God would have us pray for those people, because I guarantee that same person that might have, you know, been executing Christians because they're Christians, the best way of stopping them from doing that is converting them to Christianity, letting them know what the truth is. That's the only way. Okay, I'll get off that soapbox now. Aaron's got a question over here.
What you were just saying, Kevin, is what was the question I was going to ask. Jesus said, you have heard that it is said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. What you were just saying, you know, it seems like we pray, we put on the full armor of God, and then when someone gets in our face or we see something like that happening where our brothers or sisters are getting persecuted and their heads are being cut off, or someone that we are close to hurts and despitefully uses us, how important, or can you give some practical steps of walking in the Spirit so that you're not reacting to these things, but you're actually walking in the Spirit. So when those things, you see those things happening, or when they actually happen to you, we can fulfill this impossible command from Jesus by walking in the Spirit.
Well, and I think you kind of answered your own question in the sense it's putting on the full armor of God. It's being in the Spirit, right? So because if we're in the Spirit, we're not going to react in the flesh. And that's the key to it. So the first thing to do is having that close, intimate walk with Jesus. You know, because if we, you know, here's the thing, you know, preparation is key, right? If we're not in prayer and in God's Word and walking with Him daily, hourly, then we're not going to be equipped, you know, because like it said there in Ephesians, it's not in our power, it's not in our might, it's only in His. You know, it's to me, it's the picture I had. So I had two older brothers, one was 11 years older and one was 10 years older. So these guys, you know, they were like my idols growing up, my two oldest brothers. Then I had one closer to me in age who was 4 years older. So I knew I could irritate my brother who was 4 years older. And before he could, if I could get to my two oldest brothers before this one beat me up, I'd be safe. You know, so I had run to my older brothers, you know, after I irritated this brother, right? And that's kind of the picture I see with God too, is it, when we're walking closely with Him and we're right there next to Him, when these storms of life, whatever they are, when people come against us, where people, you know, talk bad about it, whatever the case may be, when we're walking with God, we're walking in the Spirit, we're not going to react in our flesh, right? And how do we do that? So some of the practical things, like I said, prayer, God's Word, fellowship, having people in your life who love you enough to say, you know what, you're being a big fat jerk right now and you need to stop. You know, God, that was probably a politically incorrect way of saying it, but you know what I'm saying is you're not acting the way you should be acting. You're not responding the way you should be. You're not being Christ-like right now. Knock it off, right? We need to have people in our lives who are brave enough and love us enough, you know, to hold us accountable to God's Word. You know, and we should be able to do that in their lives. So that's important, too, that we surround ourselves with people who are willing and who love us enough to be able to do that. So, you know, to me, it's kind of an all immersive thing. You know, it's prayer, it's being in God's Word, and it's being around people that are bold enough and love us enough to tell us when we're getting off course. But the key is, you know, it's His power, it's His might, not ours. We need to respond in the Spirit and not the flesh. And you know, it's difficult sometimes, let's be honest. It really is, and especially when it's something that's personal. It can become real difficult. But like I said, if we're prepared, or we're, we've been in that place where we're walking in the Spirit, we're reading His Word, we're in constant prayer, then we're equipped to handle those things, because we're going to do it in His power and in His might, and not try to do it in our flesh. Because when we do it in our flesh, things just kind of get blown up, and then we got to go back and, you know, try to repair all these things that we didn't need to if we would have been responding in the Spirit instead of in the flesh. So those would be what I would think of. So does that kind of answer it there? All right, any other questions in here?
Yeah, I have one, Pastor. Thanks for taking this topic. I know it's
a different... Oh, there you are. Yeah, I was wondering, sorry. I was like, who has the mic?
Yeah. Thanks for taking this topic. I know it's a difficult topic and also become a very divisive topic, but, you know, in light of the scriptures that you gave tonight, what you talked about, I oftentimes have looked through the scriptures, old and new, and we see guys like Jehu and Samson and David and Barak and Gideon, and you see mighty men of valor, you know, in the Old Testament who had to shed blood, mm-hmm. and they did it in God's name, you know. And then you see, in contrast, in the New Testament, you see Jesus saying, turn the other cheek. And as our brother over here just shared, pray for your enemy, love those, persecute you, bless them, and do not curse. And so those things seem to be contradictory to each other at first, but they're more like a truth held in tension. You know, and being a military man, being in the Marine Corps for the time I struggled with a lot of those things myself. But do you think that there's a time when perhaps, you know, like if you're walking down an alleyway and you see a lady getting beat or robbed or worse, is that a time for me to pray, or is that a time for me to intervene and be a warrior, put on my Jehu hat, you know, versus my Jesus, you know what I'm saying?
I do, and I've told this example to some of you who have been in there. I was preaching down at a river bottom in Southern California, right? And as I'm preaching, this lady, she takes a loaf of bread and throws it in this guy's face, right? And I'm kind of watching this as it's going on, and the next thing I know, this girl hits this guy, right? Clocks him. And then the next thing I know, these two are fighting back and forth. So I'm sitting here preaching, right? And I'm going, all right, Lord, what do I do here? And then finally, it was just like, I can't watch this guy beat this girl, you know, drop the Bible. Next thing I knew, me and him were rolling in the river bottom, and, you know, as I'm subduing him. So to me, that's different, okay? Because what are you doing there? You're not for, you know, ungodly purposes or for greed. You're not robbing this lady. You're not doing anything. You're trying to protect her, right? This is one of God's daughters that somebody's doing something evil to them, and you're protecting them. There's a time for action like that. That's not really what it's talking about. You know, yeah, God cares about that person, but at the same time, there's an immediacy. You know what I'm saying? Where is there more responsibility for you just to say, oh, I'll pray for you as she's getting beat or raped or whatever? Then her blood's kind of on your hands from my perspective. If you have the ability to do something about it and you don't, then to me, you know, you're as responsible as the person doing something. So that's the difference. Yeah, we're supposed to pray, but if I'm going to be honest, I'm going to be praying as I'm running over to clock the guy. You know, I mean, that's just the way it is, because we need to protect, the weaker vessel, right? In this particular case, we need to get the guy off of her. It's just kind of human decency. Does that make sense?
Yeah, roger that. Thank you, Pastor.
Yeah. And as far as war goes and the kind of things, you know, once again, you as a Marine, first of all, God bless you and thank you for your service. But secondly, being a warrior, being called to that kind of thing, once again, there's a line there. If you're following the rules of engagement and you're doing what you're supposed to do and you're taking orders from those that God's put in authority, like we read earlier, then you're doing exactly what you were called to do. You were given skills as a soldier that I couldn't go out and do. God gave you those skills, and you were using them to protect the country. You were given a task. You know what I'm saying? So to me, that's a honorable purpose that not all of us could do. But God wired you that way. He gave you the physical and mental skills to be able to do it. So I appreciate that. Any other questions? Oh, we got one over here. You can have as many as the Spirit gives you. And online, Brendan, Mr. Bean, I agree with you. We read those verses earlier, and that's where Brendan wrote, he quoted 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, which we talked about, you know, being in prayer. So, go ahead, Mike.
Okay, hey, in Psalms 109, David invokes prayer to God to fight his enemies. He asks God to fight the battle to curse them. So when we pray to deal with situations that are occurring, would that be acceptable? I mean, do you see that being acceptable of just saying, hey, I want God, please, if you're going to have them curse me, bring that same curse back onto you, for an example.
Yeah, I love David, you know, and I love the way sometimes David would pray, you know, it's like, Lord, knock their teeth out, you know, break their bones. And I understand him, but, you know, I think as Aaron, aptly brought up is really, we're supposed to pray for our enemies. We're supposed to pray for their salvation, because with it comes, they're no longer our enemies, right? We're on the same team at that point. So I understand David's heart, because I prayed that same way. Like I was saying earlier, you know, Lord, drop the missile right on this guy's head. Or better yet, just maim him and let him bleed out slowly, you know. In Jesus' name, amen. But let's be honest. Well, I mean, we chuckle, but I bet we've all had the same kind of prayer, you know, and when I read some of David's writings, I think about that, you know, because I know, I understand where he's coming from there. Lord, knock their teeth out, you know, I mean, curse my enemies, but better yet, convert my enemies. You know, that's really the heart of Jesus and what, you know, really the way we should be praying. Huh? He is our King. Amen. All right. Do we got any more questions in here? Oh.
So, thank you, Mike, for that question. So, Pastor Kevin, can you tell us the difference between being angry at a person compared to angry at what the person is committing? In other words, the action, the sin, and not being, how is it possible to be angry at the sin and not be angry at the person?
Well, I think one, it goes back to being in the Spirit and being in the flesh. You know, God hates sin, so should we. So being angry at the sin, I hate abortion. I hate pornography. I hate all these things that stumble so many people. Absolutely detest it, but I don't hate the people that practice it. I pray for them. I have compassion for them, because there's so many people caught in those webs of sin. So to me, it's the whole, once again, it's the whole response of in the Spirit or in the flesh, you know, because it's real easy for us to hate or want to hate, you know, somebody who has committed murder or molested a child or whatever the case may be, yeah, the flesh says, I want to hate them, and really I want to take them out. You know, if you give me 30 seconds in a room alone and there was no consequences, you know, the results probably wouldn't be good, kind of thing. But God would have us pray for those people, you know. God would, of course, we hate the sin, just as, or we should. If we're in the Spirit, we're going to hate the sin because God hates it. But if we're in the Spirit, we're going to, or if we're in the flesh, we're going to hate the person, you know. And no, God wants us to hate the sin and pray for the person, because ultimately the answer is the same for a child molester or a murderer or an embezzler or whatever the case is. The answer is still the same, and the answer is Jesus. Just as it is for an ISIS terrorist or you know, the average nice person on the street who don't know Jesus. It's all the same. The cure is Jesus. No other way. Any other questions? And yeah, Sheila, righteous anger is kind of what we're talking about. I'm answering an online question. And really what that is just anger that is kind of spirit-led, in the sense of, once again, you know, we are to hate the things that God hates, and we're supposed to stand up against. We should have righteous anger against pornography. We should, the fact that, you know, our country and courts have allowed it to be piped into our homes, or we should have righteous anger, you know, over abortions. I keep using those examples, but those are the two biggest ones I can think of right now. So yes, Sheila, we should have righteous anger over those things. So, and then we have one that says, I hate that with war, innocent kids and people have to die. I understand the need for war in the biblical perspective, but my heart breaks for the innocent. Thank you, Lord, that you work all things together for good and you're on the throne always. Thank you, Lord, that one day there will be no more pain and no more tears. Amen to that. That was my lovely wife. She has so much wisdom. Hi, honey. All right, any other questions in here? Trying to score points. We're going on vacation in a week, so, you know, just, yeah. So now that I embarrassed her, I just lost all the points that I gained. So, but, yeah, no, that's okay. Oh, do they? Well, go. Would you give my wife a call, please? Okay, we're rabbit trailing again. Okay. Any other questions? Any more questions online? No, going once. Oh, my wife wrote hi. Okay, that's the issue with doing this online at the same time I'm doing it here. It's real easy to go to get sidetracked. So Sheila wrote, thank you. We need to pray for children and women who are put in human trafficking. We absolutely do. It's another evil that the church needs to deal with, and I think we could do a much better job of protecting and ministering to those who have been caught in sex trafficking. And, you know, like Sheila said, we definitely need to pray. And so as we close, and there doesn't seem to be any more comments, I'm going to ask Pastor Steve not only to kind of summarize things, but if he would pray for the Middle East and pray for the sex trafficking and all these things that we've talked about.
We read earlier in the scriptures in Ephesians 6, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God. It was asked, how do we be mad at the sin and not at the sinner? Look past the sinner and see what's causing it. What is the reason of the sin? And we find there is a malevolent spirit behind it somewhere. And when we see someone who's held against their will, held captive in sin, we can start to be sympathetic with them and get angry at the real cause, the enemy, who is defeated in prayer. So there's no, flesh will never do any good to fight this enemy. It's our weapons of our warfare are not carnal, right? But they're mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds.
Amen.
Right? And then it says, casting down every argument that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and holding all things captive to the obedience of Christ. So when something, you know, there's the battlefield of the mind. We see there in Ephesians 6, it talks about the helmet of salvation. How many of you know that there's a battle going on over our mind? And we don't want to let the devil rent space in our head. And the way that we do that is we stay in the Word and we get in the Spirit. And then when the enemy comes, we get a thought flying through our head that says, you know what, you're not blank enough. You don't pray enough. You're not a good enough Christian. You don't witness enough. You don't study enough. You're just not enough. And if we believe that, we're going to go, wow, I'm just not enough, and we'll get depressed. Let me tell you this. Jesus is our enough. He's enough for us, right? He is. So anything that exalts itself or any imagination that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, that is who you are in Jesus, exalting itself against what He has done in your life, what He has promised you in His Word, anything that comes against that, you can categorically deny and cast down without exception. It's a lie.
Mm-hmm.
And hold all things captive to the obedience of Christ. Now, we need to get that helmet of salvation on. Some folks go into battle and they don't have their helmet on, right? They go into battle. And yeah, they get their head lopped off, right? And He's given us the whole armor. And it says, and having taken up the whole armor of God, stand. Having done all to stand, stand therefore. It's a promise. If we've done all to stand, we will stand. And we're standing not in our might, but in His might. Amen?
Amen.
Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. His might. I like what the angel said to Zerubbabel, because Zerubbabel was looking at the rebuilding of the temple, and he had great opposition. And the Lord says, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Who is this mountain that stands before Zerubbabel? It shall become a plain. How? By shouting grace unto it. And folks, the grace of God at the name of Jesus is available to you. And when you seek Him in that moment when things start to get heated and you feel like you're going to get drug into the fleshly battle and start to hate people, which we're never to do, we can turn to Him and call upon the name of Jesus, and our hearts will be softened, and we'll realize that we don't wrestle with flesh and blood. And through humility, we can take a right track. And sometimes we've got to deal with bad guys. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was faced with this in Germany. In the 1930s, he's a pastor in Germany. He didn't like the Nazi aggression. He actually has understudied Mahatma Gandhi for a couple of years, and he's studying pacifism. And he started to go that direction. He went to the United States and got in a black gospel thing going on the East Coast, got filled with the Holy Ghost, and that was really good. And he was considering taking a pastorate. But the Holy Spirit worked on his heart so mightily, he said, how can I leave my countrymen, the Germans, in an hour of their greatest need? And he took the last steamer back into Germany before the Battle of Britain started in 1939. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, quite a man of God, at a time when the whole German Christian church was capitulating into Nazi aggression, at a time when the trains were carrying people, the Jews, to Auschwitz. And what the people would do is just sing all the louder as the trains went by with the people wailing on the way to the gas chambers. Dietrich did something different. He started something in Finkenwald called the Confessing Church, where there was a group of 5,000 pastors that would not capitulate to Adolf Hitler. And as he was studying the fifth chapter of Matthew, looking at the Beatitudes, he realized that it was Jesus' intent that the new man in Christ could walk in such a thing, that it was available, tenable for us to walk in the Beatitudes of Christ. And being challenged with that, he was faced with a question. If it were possible to stop someone like Adolf Hitler, if it were possible to stop such a monster, should I? And eventually, Dietrich Bonhoeffer was caught in a conspiracy to kill, to assassinate Adolf Hitler. Dying for that conspiracy and dying in his faith in Jesus Christ 2 weeks before Hitler killed himself. So sometimes there is action, brother. But I don't think Dietrich hated any of them, because we read his letters and the statements and the guards that were there that were watching him before he went to the gallows. Those Germans knew that Dietrich loved them. And I don't think he hated Adolf, but he hated the devil behind it. And we're always to hate the devil behind it, but to love the people. So we need to get our helmet of salvation on, guys. And remember, above all, holding up the shield of faith, which is able to quench the fiery darts of the evil one. Let's pray. Father, thank you for tonight. Lively topic here tonight. A timely question in our day. And Lord, we do need to have our hearts checked to not hate. We don't rejoice in that Soleimani was killed. We do rejoice in that no more evil will come through this man. In that we rejoice. Lord, help us to have a right heart, as these days we're evidently in the last days. And we're seeing things wax worse and worse, just like you said, Jesus. Help us, Lord, to not get sucked into the emotions of being on the wrong side of issues. Help us, as is said here tonight, to hate sin, but to love the sinners. And we can only do that with your help, Lord, walking in the Spirit. Lord, there's so many things in our day, so many things at this hour. As Pastor Kevin has said, we say something is so wrong, yet killing babies is right. We can suffer over one eagle egg in California that's broken, yet thousands die every day as the unborn. Lord, we live in an upside-down world, and how we long for you to come and straighten it out. But Lord, we don't rejoice in that anyone is judged to an eternal hell. We wouldn't wish that one on Soleimani or Hitler or anyone. Because, Lord, we're worthy of it. And you paid the greatest price that we wouldn't have to go there. That we would have access to your Father in place in your family. Help us to have a right heart in these last days. And, Lord, help us in our day, as Dietrich did in his day, to not capitulate in our walk with you, but to stand strong and resolute for the truth. Help us. Help me. Help the church. And we pray these things in Jesus' name and ask your grace upon us as we go out. Amen.
Amen. All right. Thank you all for coming, and thank you all for watching online. God bless you. Have a great week in the Lord.